It is my honor to introduce tonight's lecturer, Ta-Nehisi Coates. Ta-Nehisi Coates is a journalist, author, educator. Currently, he's senior editor for the Atlantic Monthly. His recent cover story, The Case for Reparations, became one of the fastest-selling issues in the magazine's history. It has sparked a nationwide conversation about the legacy of racism and white supremacy. And it even earned Coates an in-depth profile in the Washington Post, as well as a return guest spot on the Colbert Report. You saw the episode. After listening to Coates describe the social, economic, and political injustices against black Americans, even after slavery and Jim Crow, comedian Stephen Colbert described the case for reparations as, quote, well-argued, exhaustively researched. I can understand it, but I don't want to understand it. Coates has a popular blog at The Atlantic, which was recently named one of the best top 25 blogs by Time magazine. He's the author of The Beautiful Struggle, a memoir about growing up in West Baltimore, and the influence of his father, who was a former Black Panther and editor over at the Black Classic Press, a small publishing house specializing in African American studies. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Ta-Nehisi Coates.
Thank you guys for coming out to see me. This is quite the crowd. It's pretty incredible. So for most of my life, I have been deeply concerned with the plight of African Americans in this country. And when you're concerned with the plight of African Americans in this country, that means being concerned with questions of racism and white supremacy. I am from Baltimore, Maryland. I grew up in Baltimore in the 80s and in the early 90s, a period that was marked by, a great degree of difficulty in our nation's history. People talk about the murder rate in Chicago right now, and they really have no idea. They've lost all perspective. In the 1980s, murder, crack, HIV, just a host of problems had beset our cities. And, you know, there was a kind of fear that had really taken hold of folks who lived in these cities and folks who lived in Baltimore. And I think the fear was very much rooted in the fact that we were, you know, I was born in 1975, so we're about 7 years after the assassination of Dr. King. So we're not, you know, the civil rights movement is not just in recent memory. I mean, it is like right there. It's touchable right there. And yet here we were living in these cities and living in these places and beset by these problems when you know, Dr. King talked about us, you know, getting to the mountaintop. That was not, you know, what folks imagined. And the question, you know, was lodged in my head at a very, very young age when I would go outside and, you know, look in my neighborhood and, you know, compare notes with my friends and think about all the forces arrayed against us. And then I would come home and cuddle my TV and watch a show like Family Ties. And I would observe the difference between the world that I lived in and the world that America projected out of itself. And the distance, the gulf was tremendous. I had two parents at home. I had a mother and I had a father who by the time I was born were pretty well educated. My mother was a teacher. My father was a research librarian. So all those sort of reasons that people posit for why black life is, you know, not there, the absence of fathers, you know, lack of education, was not really present in my house. I lived in a veritable library. There was just books everywhere. You know, books in the living room, books in the dining room, you know, books in my room, books in the bathroom, kitchen, books tumbling everywhere. So we were plenty well educated. You know, we were plenty well informed. And yet, I can recall being 11 years old and going to elementary school in the fifth grade and coming out of my elementary school and watching two young men get into a conflict and watching another one of them stand back and reach into his ski jacket. I can see it now and pull out a handgun like this. And I was 11, and again, I would come home, and you know, you look at TV, and you see America as it projects itself, and the distance between your life, because I knew somewhere in the world there were 11-year-olds who were not, you know, worried about their personal safety, who did not have people pulling out handguns. That was Baltimore in 1986, and I have been obsessed since that time with understanding the gulf between us, the chasm between my world, the world of black people, in the world of the rest of this country. And that is a motivating force in all of my journalism. Even when I'm not necessarily writing about, you know, something that has to do with racism, it is the huge motivating question for all of my journalism. And it's a question that I think a lot of people have besides me. And as I began the case for reparations, I picked up an issue of the New York Times, and it was about a particularly elite public school in New York City. Anybody here from New York City? Any people? Okay. All right. Okay. Well, so for you, those of you here, it was about Stuyvesant. Stuyvesant is being sued by the NAACP Legal Defense Fund because it has a appallingly low population of African Americans in the school, and Latinos also. And so I picked up the article. And it was all about, you know, these efforts, you know, should Stuyvesant, you know, go from it, away from its methods, which right now is just a straight test, to something more open that allows for a more inclusive student body. And on the other side of this issue was not white people, but was Asian students and Asian American students who were coming into New York and were taking the test and were doing quite well. And the profile gave a really good picture of why these folks were doing well. You know, it was the one kid who was featured in there, as I recall. He was living with his grandparents. His grandparents owned the cleaners. And he was staying upstairs in the apartment. And he basically was busting his backside studying, you know, night in and you know, day in and day out for this test. And that was the story for a lot of these students. And so I found myself, in fact, in deep sympathy with these students, not with the African-American students. And towards the end of the article, a young lady who had a child who, you know, she was trying to get a child into a decent school, she said, I don't really feel like my child should have to study day in and day out to get into a decent school. And this actually pissed me off. I got really upset about that. I pissed it out. What do you mean? Everybody got to work. What are you talking about? I was like ashamed of it as a black person. I was like, come on. You know, we have a certain vocabulary that I won't use right now when we're among ourselves that, you know, was really going through my head at that moment, right? But see, here's the lesson. Here's the lesson right here. You know, I got pissed off. And I went to bed, and I went to bed pissed off, woke up pissed off. And it started dawning on me, right? And I should have known that, in fact, there are many people who live in this country, and there are many people who live in New York City who don't have to study day in and day out to get their kids into a good school. That in fact, what the woman was articulating was that she had to go through that struggle because her child lived in a certain neighborhood. And there's an entire history behind why African Americans live in certain neighborhoods and why they don't. I read this article. I had been doing some writing about gentrification, which everybody in New York is talking about gentrification. I just get tired of hearing about it. Gentrification. And I get tired of hearing about it because it's a cover for another discussion. And that's what became clear to me. The fact of the matter is, right now at this moment, or at least at the time I wrote the case for reparations, I don't know where it's at right now, I believe that white people have 20 times the wealth as African Americans if you're going by family. So if you look at your average African American family, they have about 1/20th of the wealth of your average white family. If you broaden this out and go from families and start looking at neighborhoods. A lot of people talk about, you know, we don't understand what's happening with African Americans. When we control for income, we still see these discrepancies. And this is something that, you know, I should have known, knowing how I grew up. There is no African American middle class in the American popular sense of an African American middle class. So not only are you dealing with a population of people who may, you know, make a certain amount of money, maybe of a generation that, you know, get to a certain level, but they're one generation out of it, usually, maybe two generations. And the way they are out of it is not the way that most white people are out of it. I may come to a school like Cornell, do really well, go get a nice job as a lawyer, but the fact of the matter is my younger brother probably won't do so well. I may have to help out with him. I may have to help out with my mother. I come from a neighborhood where people don't necessarily have the same sort of social connections that other folks have. And so my social connections are a little bit poorer. I don't have a mother or grandmother who went to certain places and, you know certain people when I'm out there looking for the job. What do we call this? Social capital. Yeah. So I don't just have a wealth deficit, I actually have a social capital deficit. And then if you look at the numbers in terms of my neighborhood, you start measuring. The average African-American family that makes $100,000 lives in the kind of neighborhood that is typical for the average white person that makes $30,000. You can see that's a grave difference. You know, and when you start thinking about this, when you go from not just the individual, but to the family, to the community, and then you imagine these communities and these families interacting with each other, because African Americans are the most segregated community in this country, and have historically been the most segregated community in this country. Don't ever let anybody, you know, draw a comparison for you between, say, African Americans and the immigrant ghettos, the Irish ghettos, the Jewish ghettos. It's not comparable. I can run the numbers for you, but if you know, if you guys are interested in reading something, you should check out American Apartheid. It's excellent on this and really goes and gives you the numbers of how hyper-segregated, as they call it, the African-American community is. There was a report that recently came out, and it was applauding the end of segregation in America. And the good news was that the numbers for African-Americans had receded to about where they were in 1920. But African-Americans were still the most segregated, you know, group of people in this country. White people were less segregated, but that's because Asian-Americans and Latinos were moving into their neighborhoods. So we have this thing, this wealth gap that's beneath everything. It doesn't really get talked about. How did it get here? How did it happen? You know, this is what I mean when I talk about like the ahistorical nature of our conversations. We don't talk about like why we're here. We act like it's some great mystery. We walk around, you know, we talk about everything else. You know, maybe if your father was around, everything would be okay. Maybe if you did this, maybe a black girl stopped having babies, you know, it would be okay. And in ignorance of the stats, too. I mean, people just throw things out, you know, because they feel like it. But what we like is a serious interrogation of why things are the way they are. And the fact of the matter is, we know why they are the way they are. And I'll just take you through this, you know, very brief history, which all of you guys know. The way we talk about, because I'm at Cornell, I know everybody knows. the way we talk about African-American history and the problems of African-Americans in this country tends to be in the manner of, through the lens of manners, as I call it. If you ever hear anybody that says something racist, like the latest Clive and Bundy, which will happen in the next 2 weeks or so, I assure you, the first thing that person says, or the person who is defending them says, is, well, such and such can't be a racist, they're a good person. he has such a good heart, there's no way he could be a racist. I've known him since he was 5 years old, he's such a great person. There's no possible way he could be a racist. He's such a great father, there's no way, you know, he could be a racist. You know, as though like Thomas Jefferson and all the white supremacists, you know, who come up to this time were bad fathers. They must have been, you know, bad fathers that you know, it's the only way they could be racist. This is about the heart, because we believe racism to be a disease of the heart. We believe that if you are a racist, you are necessarily unqualified, a bad person right off the bat. We basically, you know, taken the connotation of slur somewhere in the neighborhood of child molester. That's sort of how we regard it, basically. So racism is not something that afflicts an entire society. It is something that, you know, afflicts you know, a certain small group of orcs who live over here and should be shunned, you know, out of society. You know, and if you believe racism afflicts orcs, it's very easy to believe that, well, I don't know who's actually racist, you know? So my argument that I make, one of the primary things in the case for reparations, is that American, the force of American racism and the force of white supremacy in this country is not a disease of the heart, it's a disease of the pocketbook. And that is the correct way to understand the plight of African Americans in this country. There is a reason why the most quoted speech from Martin Luther King is "I Have a Dream." It makes everybody, especially a section of people quote, it's not even just the whole speech, the section of people quote makes everybody feel good. Everybody can get into, you know, the idea of little white girls and little black girls holding hands and little, you know, whatever. You guys know the speech now. No disrespect to Dr. King, but it's been quoted over and over and over and over and over again. You know, and a lot of his other stuff is a lot less quoted. For you know, very obvious reasons. We can all get into the, like the heart aspect, the idea of being nice to each other, but the thing we can't get into is the idea of how about we stop taking things from black people. And this is, I believe, this is, I argue, is the dominant theme in American history from 1619 up to the present. When enslaved African Americans first came here, enslaved Africans, when they arrived on this shore, the idea of unfreedom is not unfamiliar. As I'm sure most of you know, there was a population here of indentured servants. And you know, indentured servitude means I pay for my transport to this country, to these colonies, to Virginia, say, for instance, by pledging me, you know, pledging my labor to you for 7 years, and I'll work for you, and I, you know, sacrifice my freedom on that behalf. If you look at the history of indentured servitude in this country, what you will find is many things that are shockingly familiar. You can find indentured servants getting the hell beat out of them. You can find masters of indentured servants altering contracts to make sure indentured servants serve longer. You can find, in fact, masters gambling with the contracts of indentured servants and trading between them. So much of the things that we would later associate with the institution of enslavement in this country were already present here. So Africans arrived, and what you see immediately is not racism as we know it today. Another thing that, you know, we like to think about is that somehow it is natural because you know, you have more melanin than me, or I have less melanin than you, because my hair kinks a certain way for me to hate your guts. That's somehow, you know, evolutionary, you know, manifestation of something real, and somehow we can educate ourselves. But in fact, racism is a creation of our modern moment, and by our modern moment, I mean the past 400 or 500 years. The contact between Africans and Europe is not new. It's much older than 400 or 500 years, and yet the tropes that we find in effect strangely only appear after the slave trade. Funny how that works. And so enslaved Africans come here, and what you see is in a colony like Virginia, or in, you know, all of our colonies, where you have this vast amount of land, and people are looking for ways to extract wealth from the land. They need a way to do it as efficiently as possible. And it, you know, eventually becomes clear that one way of doing that is having a permanently bonded population of people who are bonded for life and whose kids are bonded for life. And this can allow for the maximum extraction of wealth. I really wish Ed Baptiste was here. I know he had to go down to FAMU. Shout out to Ed Baptiste. You need an efficient way of extracting. This is all his book is about. I mean, he talks all about this. That's why I wish he was here. You need an efficient way for extracting. But this doesn't just help in terms of the economy. This actually offers you a stable basis for a democracy, because in a state like Virginia, where you're talking about something like 30% of the people who are living there are in bondage, or you're talking about a state like South Carolina, where at the start of the Civil War, the majority of people are living in bondage, or in Mississippi, where the majority of people are living in bondage, Louisiana, where something like half of the people are living in bondage, Georgia, Alabama, what you have is you have a bonded working class. You have a group of people whose freedom is automatically restricted, and this allows for a kind of stability and a kind of equality among white people. And so the argument that I make in reparations, and this is nothing new for the historians in the room, is that when you understand slavery, we like to think about it as something that happened in spite of our democracy, or everything would have been okay had we not, you know, killed all the Native Americans and enslaved black people. But in fact, we might not exist had we done those two things. We certainly would not exist as we are today. You come up to the time of the Civil War, and a few years ago, I went on a deep binge into the Civil War. I went out to all these battle parks, and this is getting better, but if you visit Civil War battlefields, one of the things you'll find is everybody wants to talk about everything except what the Civil War was over. So they want to talk about what flanking maneuver General Lee did here. What clothes the average private was wearing, or what rifle they were toting. But you ask them, why were you shooting that rifle? You know what I mean? For a long time, before I did this deep dive, I thought maybe it was because, you know, the history wasn't clear. Maybe there was some sort of intelligent debate to be had about why the Civil War was fought. In fact, there is no intelligent debate at all to be had about why the Civil War was fought. And we know this because if you look at, you know, the people who started the Civil War, the South, the Southerners, who initiated the Civil War to form a nascent Confederacy, were very clear about why they were initiating the Civil War. One can go back and read the Declarations of Secession. For a state like Mississippi, I believe the very first sentence is, our interest is thoroughly identified with the institution of slavery. I mean, it's the first sentence, dude. You know what I mean? Like, in terms of your reason for why you left, it's the very first sentence, okay? And it's the same if you look at the documents of secession for South Carolina, for Virginia, for the Confederate states. If you read the cornerstone speech by the vice president of the Confederacy, Alexander Stevens, the cornerstone is black inequality. It's the fact that the natural position for black people is to be as slaves. And so there's really no doubt, you know, about why the Civil War was fought. And then you start looking at the numbers. And you consider the fact that in 1860, the dominant export from this country was cotton. Cotton, obviously, extracted by the labor of slaves. You understand that the greatest institution of wealth, more than all our productive capacity in this country put together, all our railroads, all our nascent factories, all our everything, was the enslaved bodies of Africans. When you understand that if you wanted to find a region where the largest per capita group of millionaires lived in this country, you would have to go to the Mississippi River Valley down south. That's where you'd find them. I wonder why. You know, it wasn't New York. It wasn't Boston. When you understand that the interstate trade and slaves generated millions and millions of dollars, you know, many times over every year. When you understand that everything was tied to this, don't just think about the guy who's, you know, literally, you know, holding somebody on his farm. Think about, like, the government, or think about the insurance companies, you know, that have to, you know, offer insurance on a slave. Think about the government that has to deal with a will when a slave master dies and has to dispense slaves in every direction depending on what the will says. Think about the social institution of slavery, the fact that in many slaves, all whites, whether they were slave owners or not, had to serve on slave patrols. Think about the journals like DeBow's Review, where if you walk over to the library, and I'm sure Cornell has a nice collection, if you walk over to the library, you can see people trading tips on the best way to extract labor from slaves in much the same way that one might trade tips on a home, on how to expand a patio or something like that. This was an institution, and it was at our core, so much so that 600,000, and the numbers are being revised upwards every day, people died in a war. And you have to wonder why. And when you, we know why. We know why. And yet when you see that the memory has been so, so repressed, you wonder what's going on. And then you say the extraction didn't end after slavery, that it continued. That if you looked at the Jim Crow South, you would find African Americans effectively bonded to the land through the institution of sharecropping. Again, resources being extracted from them. One of the primary people in my piece is a gentleman by the name of Clyde Ross. And Mr. Clyde Ross lives on the west side of Chicago. And he, I went into his house, I was working on this piece, and I said, Mr. Ross, where are you originally from? He said, I'm from Clarksdale, Mississippi. And I said, why did you come to Chicago? And he said, I was seeking the protection of the law. And he has like this thick Mississippi accent, so I thought I was misunderstanding him. I said, what do you mean you were seeking the protection of the law? He said, there was no law in Mississippi. I said, what does it mean that there was no law? He said, well, there was no black prosecutors. There were no black judges. There were no black lawyers. There were no black police. That's no law. And what he was saying was basically anybody could at any moment come and take anything from him. Any white person could take anything from him. And that's exactly what happened if you read the story. And there was no one to appeal to. He was effectively an outlaw, literally outside the law. The law existed to control him, not to protect him. And so if you can magnify that beyond Mr. Clyde Ross, who, by the way, is very much alive today. People talk about, oh, you know, anybody making a reparations claim is long dead. Mr. Ross is very much alive, just as intelligent as ever. But when you think about that redounding out through a community, whole communities in Mississippi, living outside of the protection of the law. And then if you think about the fact of African Americans coming north during the Great Migration and not finding much more protection under the law in these cities. You talk about segregation. And there's some great, great scholarship on this and the forces at work that made our neighborhoods look the way they look now. And we can go through the government policies of redlining, which I do in quite in some detail in that book. You can talk about the misapplication of the GI Bill. Which I do in some book. You can talk about the misapplication of housing policy across this country during the 1940s and 1950s when we have this formation of this great American middle class and how black people were cut out of this, effectively cut out of all these programs. And what you'll find, though, even after that, is one of the great forces that kept black people in the ghettos when they tried to move out were the riots by white people. White violence, one of the great, great forces for restraining African Americans into their neighborhoods. Housing, as we understand it today, the image that I would cut on when I would see, you know, cut on the TV and look at family ties, is the product of government action. It is a product of social engineering. So anybody that, you know, gets up and talks to you about African Americans and say, well, you want the state to do X, Y, and Z, I mean, you should just laugh at them. I was talking to somebody yesterday, and, you know, I don't know, you know, how much of an issue this is for you guys, but the person was saying to me that one of the problems is that people who come to Cornell, African Americans who come here, resent the fact that sometimes people ask them if they are the benefit of affirmative action. And that really rankles some people, but it shouldn't rankle anyone. It shouldn't rankle anyone. The white middle class in this country is the result of state-sponsored affirmative action on a massive scale. On a massive scale. This is a socially engineered middle class. It just didn't exist without it. The 1930s, we're coming out of the Great Depression. Roosevelt is coming in. And folks are looking for a way to make home ownership more attractive and more possible for the masses of people in this country. And what the federal government comes up with through HOLC, the Homeowners Loan Corporation, and later through the FHA, the Federal Housing Administration, is that they will back loans for people. And what that means is not necessarily that they're going to give you a loan, but what that means is when a private company decides that they'll give you a loan, if you default, the government will take it up. And as you can imagine, that, you know, spurns a great, you know, it spurns not just a lot of home loans, but it spurns home loans at very generous terms. So the 30-year mortgage, as we understand it today, for instance, interest rates go down, and suddenly for the masses of Americans, not African Americans, home ownership is available. But why not for African Americans? Because at the same time the federal government did this, it drew up maps for virtually every major city in this country. And you go see these maps today. And in these maps, what you have is basically color-coded sections for who lived where. And where African Americans live, not even necessarily where a majority African American population lived, but where, say, one black person had moved onto the block or two black families had moved onto the block, the color was red. And what that meant was that entire area was ineligible for government-backed loans. Now look, the mortgage industry didn't need much help to be racist. In the front. I mean, they were racist on their own. I don't want, you know, anybody to think like the government forced them into it. You know, there's plenty of literature in there. There's a great quote from the Trade Association for realtors, and they say, and I wish I had the whole quote handy, but basically what they say is, you know, you should never alter a neighborhood. You know, and the elements that might alter a neighborhood could be, you know, some sort of criminal, some sort of, you know, madam who's running a whorehouse, or an African-American, or a Negro, I guess they would have said, or a Negro of means who thinks his success has entitled him to live around white people. So the private sector did not need help, you know, to be racist. So let's just get clear about it. What you have more is a kind of collusion. And so at the very moment, you have the greatest wealth-building opportunity in American history taking place, and perhaps, you know, in the modern world, African Americans are systematically cut out of it. Everybody know what the GI Bill was? Everybody know what the GI Bill is? Okay. Same thing happened with the GI Bill. It always, you know, gives me a kick. Well, not really a kick, but it makes me upset when I see politicians, you know, go up and, you know, talk about GI Bill, how great the GI Bill to be. And I guess I sort of understand that. But the fact of the matter is the very same, you know, mechanism that was used to cut African Americans out of these home loans was used with the GI Bill. The guy who headed up the subcommittee was for the GI Bill in the House, his name was John Rankin. You're getting a lot of history today. John Rankin was arguably the most racist person to ever serve in Congress. Just do a quick Wikipedia and you'll see what I'm saying. He was from Mississippi. He headed up the subcommittee for the GI Bill. And he was deeply concerned that the GI Bill not allow all these African-American veterans who were coming back to use the GI Bill to threaten white supremacy in the South. And so the GI Bill was written so that the powers devolved down to the state. So if you, say, wanted to use the GI Bill in Mississippi and you wanted to buy a house and you were an African-American, you had to go deal with the local representative for the Veterans Administration. And you can imagine what the local representative for the Veterans Administration in Mississippi thought of you. If you wanted to use the GI Bill to further your education and you were in Mississippi, which, you know, at that time had a decent public university system, and say you wanted to go to the flagship college, well, first of all, you might set off a riot. Let's start there. You might set off a riot. But second of all, you had to, again, deal with the local representative. And so, again, you see African Americans being cut out. And the whole time this is happening, remember that African Americans are citizens of this country. That they have taken an oath, that they have pledged themselves to the social contract of this country, to be citizens, to follow the laws, to pledge their fealty to the government, to go fight in the wars, to be taxed. And yet if you live in Mississippi in the 1940s and the 1950s, you are being taxed for the maintenance of universities that you can't attend. You are being taxed for the maintenance of pools that you can't swim in. You're being taxed for a separate but equal public school system. You're being taxed for libraries that won't let you come in and borrow a book. And so the extraction continues. It's not just a matter of you being cut out. You're being cut out, set over here, and you are being systematically plundered, as you have been since the birth of this country, before the birth of this country, in fact. And this continues to this very day. There's a historian down at Temple, Heather Ann Thompson, and she wrote just a really great piece about how historians need to pay more attention to mass incarceration. It's a great, great article. And, you know, I was going through it, and I was like, all right, I got it. And then I got to this section where she talks about mass incarceration and its effects on our democracy and on our, you know, voting in particular. And it's not just felon disenfranchisement, which I'm sure you guys are familiar with. You're incarcerated in most states. You lose the right to vote right away. I think it's only two states, in Maine and maybe, can't remember the other one. It's another New England state where you don't.
Vermont,
thank you. I thought it was Vermont. I didn't want to be wrong. Always take the chance to be wrong. I should have said that. So not only do you lose the right to vote, though, but say you're in a state like New York, You're in prison, usually, in a place that is rural and, you know, usually white. When they take the census to decide, you know, who's going to get, you know, what district, they include the prisoners in the count. And so Heather Ann Thompson, you know, shows that there were like three, like at the turn, just when they were about to repeal the Rockefeller laws, there are actually three districts in New York that would not have existed if not for the force of mass incarceration, okay? Guess who was against the repeal of the Rockefeller laws? And not only that, you know, plunder doesn't end there. In fact, when the federal government goes to calculate what your median income is, so that, you know, if you're poorer, you can be eligible for certain federal funds, they count the prisoners too. They count the prisoners who live there who neither benefit from the vote or neither benefit from the federal funds. And so what you effectively have is African-American bodies being housed in prisons, being used as conduits for the energy that devolves down from the federal government. This is plunder again, and so it hasn't stopped. If you looked at the recent housing crisis, redlining was, you know, a lot of people say a long time ago, 50 years ago, it's over with, done with. Wells Fargo was sued for housing discrimination, and what the plaintiff basically alleged was that Wells Fargo was intentionally targeting African Americans. And not targeting African Americans that they had lower credit scores, not, you know, targeting African Americans for any particular, you know, ostensible reason, except race. And, you know, to a lot of people, that's ridiculous. There must have been some other reason. But in the suit, what they did was they ran the numbers, and they balanced for everything, credit score, well, et cetera. And what they found was, nevertheless, African-Americans were, for some reason, being targeted with these subprime loans. And you say, all right, maybe it's something that the math, you know, we're missing. Maybe there's some sort of variable that we're missing. But they subpoenaed the files from Wells Fargo. And they got the interactions, and what they found was people that were working for Wells Fargo referred to these loans as loans directed towards mud people, ghetto loans. And so it became very clear in the terminology. And not only that, there was a whole strategy attached to that, wherein certain African-American leaders who will go unmentioned were tapped to go into African-American communities and pitch these loans as wealth-building opportunity. Now, this is insidious. Because see, what you have in the African-American community is a knowledge that we have been cut out of other wealth-building opportunities. And so people are hungry. And so Wells Fargo figures out a way to exploit this with ghetto loans and enrolls African-American quote-unquote leaders to do part of the exploitation. When you start seeing something that you can trace back from the birth of this country, from before the birth of this country, from 1619 up till now, you are dealing with a powerful force. And yet, when I hear, you know, all this discussion, as I do, you know, about the fate of black boys or the fate of black girls or the fate of whatever black people or black families in this country, that force very often goes curiously unmentioned. People want to talk about everything, income, morals, whatever. And my argument is the reason why we don't talk about that is because it goes to the very core of who we are. If it's true that we, the beacon of democracy, as we call ourselves, you know, the force that's going to make the world safe for democracy. If it's true that all of that talk is built on plunder, built on the taking of one thing from one group to another, what does that say about us? Who are we? Now, the case for reparations, you know, obviously, you know, makes the case for all of this happening, but I think at the end of the day, it leaves us with some really, really profound questions that are not immediately apparent. But there's a reason why every time somebody stands up and says reparations, that person is belittled as though they're, you know, talking crazy, when in fact they are just citing the history of the country that they live in. And part of that is because it troubles the order on a very, very, very deep level. My argument, though, is that if we don't begin to deal with our history, I can't, you know, to be clear, tell you what lies on the other side of that mountain. I can't tell you what it means if you face up to yourself, how you reconstitute your identity. But I can tell you what will happen if you do not. Because the problem of not facing up to history is not just restrictive to the problem of black people in this country. If we can't deal with the force of white supremacy, I have no idea, and I've said this before and I'm going to keep saying it, I have no idea how we'll deal with climate change at all. Climate change is nothing but facing up to history. That's all it is. You know, for the past X number of years, you've been doing X, Y, and Z, and it's having this effect. Denialism at its core is a kind of denial. It's a denial of science, definitely, but it's also a denial of history. And if we can't face up to these inconvenient facts, if we get into this habit of deluding ourselves, of lying to ourselves, of pretending to be America the completely innocent, America the naive, we are in deep, deep trouble. And it goes way, way beyond just black people. Obviously, I care a lot about that issue. It's the issue that I said has motivated my work for years. But it isn't the only issue. This is a deep-seated American issue. I can talk all day about reparations. I would talk all day about reparations. But like I said, I'm here at Cornell University, and I would like to hear from some of the very smart people here. Thank you so much. Yes, ma'am.
There's this time when you encounter microaggressions and people don't even realize that they're actually imposing those things on you. How do you address that as a black student without seeming like you're about to start a revolution?
I think the first thing is to kind of disregard what people think of you. I think that's the first thing. If you think somebody is acting in a manner that is racist towards you, I think you should say that. But I think in saying that, your expectation cannot be that then they will behave a certain way. Disabuse yourself of the notion that you can change white people's minds. It's not up to you. It's really, really not up to you. All you can do is state the truth as you see it, be very, very clear about that, and then move on. And then move on. It's just not, you know, it really, really is not, it's not up to any of us, you know? And I think that's very, very, I think it's very important to recognize your limits. You know, people in the world in general are going to do horrible things to you. That's the nature of being a human in this world. People tend to do especially horrible things to certain groups of people. Black people tend to be one of those groups. I am not arguing for passivity, you know, but I think it's very, very clear that you be, you know, just have some idea in your head about what your mission is here. And if your mission is to change every single racist mind that you come in contact with, you're going to go crazy. You know, you need to remember who you are. And who you are not is the therapist to white America. That's not your job. That's not who you are. You know, I don't even know you, but I know that's not, you know, you don't want that title. Yeah. Nobody wants that title. Yes, ma'am.
How do we make reparations? In what form do they take?
Well, the first thing we need to do is pass John Conyers' bill. John Conyers has his H.R. 40, which he proposes every session, and has never gone anywhere when Republicans control the Congress, and has never gone anywhere when Democrats control the Congress. And what H.R. 40 basically argues for is a study for everything that I just mentioned to figure out whether reparations are actually owed and how, if so, they could be made. There are many, many ideas out there from a literal direct check to African Americans, from investment to institutions, from exemption to federal taxes. One thing, I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with this book, Ebony and Ivy by Craig Wilder. So, history of how the Ivy Leagues and just all of the really racist things they've done over the years. You know, one thing I would be remiss if I did not say it, you know, here, an institution like this, I think one great help is if the Ivy Leagues would start getting behind this idea, because I think they have a special place and a special role. That's not my idea originally, but I think it's a really, really good idea. But a country that elevates itself to a level that says, you know what, we owe this, we did something. Let's stop talking like we didn't. Let's stop talking like we don't know why this is. We'd be a significantly improved country. The first step is to stop lying to ourselves. You know, and if we can get to that, you know, I think we've improved quite a bit. And then after that, I think all sorts of beautiful ideas would follow.
I'm curious if there have been responses that you found particularly enlightening or useful that build off of or react to your essay in some way.
Not really. It is a statement on where reparations exist within the political discourse. And so once you marginalize an idea, it doesn't get that kind of back and forth, that sort of tension that we all need, you know, for great ideas to really, really prosper. I finished writing in October, November 2013, and we finished up with the editorial process like in April of 2014. So for 6 months, I had a bunch of really smart editors who beat that piece every which way. I sent it out to a number of historians, a number of sociologists, a number of, you know, journalists in Chicago who know about these issues. And I took all of their arguments into consideration when I published, because I wanted to address, you know, any argument that might be out there that could be made against it. I wanted to make sure at least I knew what it was. In the back.
Second, third, fourth generation European immigrant who will say, we understand something about your struggle. Not the only folks that struggle. Our great-great-grandparents and our grandparents fought hell here for multiple generations. And they earned all of these things that you're saying were forms of white affirmative action. Your response.
It's ridiculous. And this comes on a certain level. I mean, the other piece you get is that, well, my family, you know, got here and, you know, name, you know, whatever that year is after slavery. And so how am I, you know, a part of this? Why do I have to be, you know, indicted on this? First of all, you did not catch hell in the way that African Americans did. This is just a fact. I mean, this, you know, certainly, you know, the Irish, you know, there's certainly a history of discrimination against the Irish, certainly a history of discrimination against Italian Americans. That definitely exists, right? But the fact that other people suffered does not make that sufferance then say equal to, say, the Native Americans, you know, who were completely, you know, pillaged and robbed of land. That doesn't make it the Trail of Tears. It's not the same thing. And the same thing is true of African Americans. The period of enslavement in this country, and this is to say nothing about Jim Crow, to say nothing about red lines, to say nothing about housing discrimination, to say nothing about job discrimination. Let's just take slavery. The period of slavery in this country was 250 years. It was longer, I should say, in this world, because I guess it goes before the colonies, in this region, in this area of North America among, you know, Americans and their ancestors. It is longer than the period of freedom in this country, 250 years. You know, and the idea that that could then be followed up with plunder after plunder after plunder after plunder till we get to a point of mass incarceration where you can go into certain zip codes in a city like Milwaukee or Detroit and find something like 30 to 50% of African-American males under supervision of the state. And to compare that, it's just ridiculous. And furthermore, because this always comes up, so I'm going to go ahead and address this, the notion that you weren't here when that happened, is the most worst and vulgar form of patriotism imaginable. If you don't want any responsibility for all the, you know, whatever the awful things were that America did, then you should take none of the credit for any of the good things that America did. If you are not responsible for slavery, redlining, Jim Crow, housing discrimination, job discrimination, how about you don't celebrate the 4th of July? How about you don't say anything about George Washington ever? You weren't here. Your family wasn't here. You had nothing to do with that. It's a complete renunciation of citizenship. I mean, and I'm talking about in the deepest sense. You know, it's the right to be a citizen when everything's all good, but I don't want no part of it when, you know, trouble come around. You know, that's it's a really, really dangerous species of love. It's a self-serving sense of citizenship. We are at this very moment paying, believe it or not, on pensions for the families of veterans who fought in the Spanish-American War. Was I born when there was a Spanish-American War? Does my tax dollars go to those pensions? Yes, they do. Do the tax dollars of those people who make those complaints go to those pensions? Yes, they do. If a state is only confined to the generation of the people alive at that moment, it's not a state. Because basically it means that anything that happened, any law, any sort of financial entanglement, anything that happened before I was born, I have nothing to do with. That's anarchy. And that's deeply wrong. It's just, to me, it's just the worst, the most opportunistic kind of citizenship. So that's my rebuttal. In the back, right here.
I want to know how you feel about African Americans who existing in this moment and not thinking about the history of enslavement, and what about people who are not thinking about, you know, their brothers and sisters who are in urban schools or they're living in a wealthy community and forgetting about, or are they serving as people who are giving other people reparations? Or, I mean, are reparations just a physical or monetary value? I mean,
we should never, first of all, demean a physical and monetary value. Money represents other things. You know, money is not, you know, money is just paper, but it represents other things. It's the expression of things. So there's nothing wrong with monetary value. There was certainly nothing wrong with monetary value when people wanted to take it from African Americans. So there's nothing wrong with that. At the same time, I think that, like, this sort of facing up with history is like the power to change people in a way. And I say that as somebody who went through this, just a small history. When I came to Howard University, in 1993, I was obsessed with this notion of uplifting, you know, the cult of black nobility. And so the idea was, you know, Saul Bellow had this quote that everybody, you know, some people might know, but that was oft repeated at the time. And the quote was, who is the Tolstoy of the Zulus? And it was basically an attack on, you know, the ascendant multiculturalist moment at that time, that, you know, we must, you know, acknowledge the fact that Africans and, you know, other people don't really have civilization in the way the white people have civilization. And, you know, I was obsessed with that. And my idea was that I must find, you know, the Tolstoy of the Zulus. You know, I was obsessed with finding, you know, proving that the Egyptians were black, proving that, you know, such and such had built walls in this place, or here's a great work that black people did. And there's nothing wrong with all of that. But what I quickly realized was that I was falling into a trap. And the trap was to accept the premise of Saul Bellow's question from the jump. And Ralph Wiley had this great retort where he said, you know, he said, who's Tolstoy the Zulus? And Wiley says, Tolstoy is the Tolstoy of the Zulus. That the question itself is premised on the idea that there's something in Russian blood or Russian bones or white bones that makes it, you know, relevant. Tolstoy is the born where he was born and therefore says something about black people. Listen, I say all that to say that a confrontation with your history has a great ability to change you in a profound way. It took me from, you know, just a kind of straight, if kind of curious, questioning black nationalist to a humanist. But the fact of the matter is this. I feel as though I can no longer be lied to. And that's a great feeling. I say it's a great, great feeling. Whatever anybody else says and whatever anybody else does, you know, I can't change that. But me, in terms of living in this world right now, at least I understand. I'm not walking around in the dark. You know, I can see the Matrix now. And that's a good feeling. That's a good feeling. Russell.
Is it a mistake to think about reparations, or the possibility of reparations, as a democracy atoning for the wrongs of this past? Shouldn't we rather think about the question of reparations in terms of a settler colony, right, the United Nations, doing what all settler colonies do, which is to plunder, right? In other words, to expect reparations from the United States government for the United States, it's akin in some respects to expecting Israel to acknowledge its own imperialism, right? It has a vested interest, material interest, psychological, etc., in the structure of white supremacy. So can we treat reparations as a
I think potentially no, but I don't know what the alternative is except those expectations. Yeah, I'm troubled by all the questions you just mentioned, you know, by the fact that you have to actually get people who, plunder is in the financial interest of people. White supremacy is in the interest of certain people. There's a reason why, you know, folks haven't parted with it. But at the same time, I frankly don't know what else to do besides stick my head in the sand. You know, I know one thing. If there's going to be any sort of reckoning, if there's purging, or if not even purging, learning to live with ourselves, you know, as a country founded on white supremacy, if that's gonna happen, then there has to be a confrontation with history. Here's the other thing. A great number of people, you know, a large countless number of people, in those 250 years of enslavement, lived here and understood that enslavement was wrong. And they lived and they died and they never saw, you know, the Civil War, 1860. They never saw emancipation. Their children lived and died. Their grandchildren lived on generations and generations of people brought here. Never saw anything. In 1859, you have Frederick Douglass who, you know, is saying, listen, the right thing to do right now is take all those 4 million people who are living in the South under chains and to free them immediately. And Frederick Douglass is thought of as crazy, and this is thought to be totally, totally impossible. In 1865, it's the policy, you know? Whenever the date is for the Seneca Falls Convention, I don't want to embarrass myself here, but whenever the date is, and folks are, you know, saying something that, even among the folks assembled there, you know, think of it as radical, you know, women should get the right to vote. 70 years later, you're talking about policy, you know? I think all the doubts you raise are really, really important. I think they're really, really significant. But I think one could have sat also in 1830 as cotton was just shooting off the chains, as the value of slaves was just as it had never been, really, in American history, and said, ain't no way we're getting out of this one. Who would have counted on, you know, white slaveholders in the South overplaying their hand? I mean, in hindsight, you could totally see it, right? I mean, it was just... It'd been overplaying their hand. You could totally see it. But at the time, it was not clear that was what was going to happen. So listen, it's quite possible that you're ultimately right, but I have no other alternative as a writer, as a thinker. I know one thing. All this other stuff that people are talking about, you know, that we hear out there is total and complete evasion. You know, and that way is not it. You know, I've pretty much disabused myself on that end. So the short answer to the very, very long answer is I don't know. I don't know.
So how, in your research, the language of people who have called for African American reparations, how does it translate compared to Southerners who asked for reparations? Anybody after any of the wars in America who asked for reparations?
Right. Yeah. I believe in objective reality. And I believe that Southern slaveholders asking for reparations for their property is just manifestly different than African Americans who have been plundered and whose parents were plundered and grandparents were plundered and generations. It's just, I just believe it's different, you know? And I, you know, it's like one of these things where there have to be certain ground rules that we agree on. And so I don't even know how to address, you know, someone who considers that, you know, to be the same thing, largely because the belief that, you know, slaveholders, for instance, should be granted reparations is a belief in my inhumanity. It proceeds from the idea that I am property, that was ever legitimate in the first place for me to be property. And as a black person, I can't ever accept that. It's an existential question. I simply can't accept it. And I can't accept it also because my ancestors did not accept it. They never believed it was legitimate. And whether the laws of the United States, you know, reflected that or not, is as far as I'm concerned, irrelevant to that question. Law, and my God, we're seeing this right now, you know, with all of these police killings. When you see somebody like John Crawford shot down, executed as far as I'm concerned, and you see the law basically able to do nothing about that, and we get these tapes, and they keep coming out week after week, and the law is powerless to do anything. You understand that the law is not the bearer of morality. The law is not something, you know, I don't want to offend anybody, but the law is not handed down by God. You know, the law is the work of humans. It's supposed to reflect some sense of justice. And when it doesn't, you know, we are supposed to do what we can do to change that fact. So I say all that to say that, you know, there must be some sort of belief in some kind of objective reality. You know, and in my reality, the claim that you should get more money for plundering my body, or plundering my ancestors' body, versus the claim that I should, you know, be repaid for the fact that you plundered me and my ancestors, it's just manifestly different.
So, like, don't you think that reparation is kind of, especially monetary reparation, is kind of a way of solidifying that movement? Because then it would be like, okay, we already paid you for all the bad stuff that happened. We already paid you for the slavery, so it's okay now. So we're done.
No, I disagree. I disagree completely. And I understand why you said that. It's not to say it's a ridiculous thing to say. That presumes that this country would ever make reparations without confronting a confrontation with history, and I don't believe it would. What you're describing is a bribe. But I don't even believe this country is capable of bribing black people. I think you think too highly of the country you live in. I mean, I think highly too, but for other reasons, you know. And the fact of the matter is, you know, I think like the Israeli example is very instructive here. There was, among survivors of the Holocaust, that belief is very much prevalent that, Germany wants to bribe us. You know, Germany's going to pay this. But in fact, this was like one of the early steps. And we're talking like just right after the Holocaust, you know, 4 or 5 years. In fact, that was one of the early steps in Germany trying to come to terms with what sort of country it was and what it had done in its past and its history. You know, I make no argument that that's perfect. You know, there's a great argument to be had about whether Germany would have been able to do that had it not killed the vast majority of the Jews living in Germany and living in the countries, in its neighboring countries. Maybe that couldn't happen. Maybe it's a lot easier to do when you don't have a population that's a political agent anymore, when they basically left. I don't know. But I do know that the argument that you know, it would just be a bribe, I think for Americans, even to bribe black people, even to get to the point where we should bribe you, you know, would take so much and would have to, you know, revolve around just so much discussion. And let's really be clear. When we think about reparations, we think about people like just mailing out a check and then, you know, everything being done. You have to think about everything that would go into living in a world where reparations was possible. We don't live in that world right now. So you can't imagine the world as it is right now, and then tomorrow, you know, Obama just signed checks to black people. That's not a world in which reparations happens at all. It's 25, 50 years down the line. It's a different place with a different consciousness, you know, among its citizens. And, you know, for those reasons, you know, I just go back to the question Russell asked, and that is, we have to believe that that sort of place is possible. You know, otherwise, what's the point? What's the point of anything?
Monetary reparations would be something that would putting effort into the actual like social structures that uphold the inequalities.
Like for instance?
Things like our education systems are totally like despairingly different. Even incarceration, investing in things like that to actually promote equality on a real basis instead of like, here's money, what do you think?
Dave Chappelle made that really, really funny skit. And so there's this idea that if you just mail checks out to black people, they would go, you know, and, you know, buy, I don't know, Cadillacs or something? Yeah. Is that the joke? I mean, whatever. I don't think that's actually true, first of all. I think you would have some black people who would do that, but I think you would have just as many black people, let's say the government mail out $100,000, you know, but I think you have a bunch of black people who would pay off their student loans. I think you got a number of black people who would pay the mortgage on their houses or would set up, you know, some sort of monetary fund. There's no real, I mean, despite the stereotypes and how we think about ourselves, there's no real evidence that black people are any less moral or any less intelligent in terms of their ability to use funds. So, you know, I don't want to take that off the table. You know, I don't know that it should solely be that, but it certainly should not be taken, like, when you know, we kind of wince when somebody says just a check, as though there's something morally wrong with money. But money represents other things. That's the thing you got. The check represents other things. The check has no, I mean, a check is just paper, you know, really, without the other things behind it. And so even when you talk about investment in education, understand you're still talking about cutting a check to somebody. You're just not talking about cutting a check to, you know, individual folks. And one thing that, you know, I guess, you know, I'm sort of in favor of some sort of reparations that helps in terms of education. But I think education, this is the wrong place to say this, I'm just gonna say it. I think education as a tool of liberation, I mean formal credentialed education in this country, is highly overrated for black people. And here is why. Here is why. There is absolutely no evidence that, you know, black people have ever taken education for granted. In fact, there's an abundance of evidence. You know, you start looking at this stuff during Reconstruction where black people are building schools. And what happened with those schools is people burnt them down. There is tremendous, a long tradition of black people going at long odds to educate themselves. If the country is determined to not grant them things, if the country is determined, and this is the sort of country we lived in the 1950s, to have black people who graduated from Howard University working at the post office, then that's what's going to happen. The unemployment rate for African Americans who graduate from college is still lower than the unemployment rate for white people that graduate from college. And so if the society can't actually recognize, you know, black people as educated people who go through the same, because what we're really talking about is credentialism, right? That's what we're ultimately talking about. I'm not talking about independent education when you go and read, you know, I'm always in favor of that. But what we're really talking about is a credentialing device. That's what, you know, what a bachelor's, you know, for most folks represents. And what you have is a situation where folks in this country don't recognize black people's credentials. We got to get past that. You know, we can have all black people we want graduating from colleges, and folks will just change the rules. They just find some other way to do it. The Rockefeller laws were enforced for, I guess, about 30 years in New York State. There was another set of laws very similar in a state like Michigan. Three strikes, you're out in California, et cetera. What mass incarceration did to black families in this country is abominable. And if we change those laws, nothing about that addresses the damage that was done 30 years before. Nothing addresses the fact that, you know, the father who ends up in jail and is not there to deal with it. It can't change that. Nothing can, you know, changing the laws is a good thing. It should be done. But this is like well within the American tradition where, say, in the 1960s, we decide we're going to stop discriminating. Yeah, but what about all the damage you did when you was discriminating? That's not the end of it. So we shouldn't conflate, you know, the obviously noble, you know, goal and the thing that should be done of changing unjust laws, racist unjust laws, with reparations, which is fixing the damage. That can't, you know, fix the 20-to-1 wealth gap. Because the 20-to-1 wealth gap is based on things that were done. And if, you know, we're going to address that, we have to do things to immediately, you know, address those directly.